Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Understanding Beliefs by Nils J. Nilsson, narrated by Don Hagen. Preface. I became interested in the subject of how people come to know things through my work in artificial intelligence and robotics. In order for robots to perform acceptably, they must know something about the worlds they inhabit. We know how robots know because we build them. Some of the knowledge that robots possess comes pre-installed by their designers and builders. Some comes more or less directly from their perceptual apparatus, what they see, read, touch, and hear. But robots can also manufacture additional knowledge in the form of explanations and conclusions for the knowledge they already have. It's the same for us humans. Perhaps our DNA encodes some knowledge as predispositions shaped by our evolution, but the rest is built on our perceptions and on our abilities to reason and to construct theories. Brain science hasn't progressed far enough yet for us to have a detailed picture of how we humans know things. Even so, cognitive psychologists and philosophers have had a lot to say about knowledge. Psychologists talk about different kinds of knowledge, two kinds in particular, knowing how, which they call procedural, and knowing that, which they call declarative. Knowing how to ride a bicycle is procedural. It's built into a program in the brain that enables bicycle riding. Knowing that a bicycle has two wheels is declarative. It can be stated as a declarative sentence. The branch of philosophy concerned with the study of knowledge is called epistemology. Philosophers distinguish how knowledge from that knowledge also. Epistemology is mainly concerned with that knowledge, the kind that can be represented by declarative sentences, which philosophers often call propositions. For example, the sentence or proposition, "The sun is fueled by thermonuclear reactions," constitutes a piece of scientific knowledge. But what about beliefs? Do our beliefs, expressed as declarative sentences, constitute knowledge? Even though some of our beliefs are less strongly held than others, I think the sum total of them does comprise a person's knowledge about the world. It's all he or she has. In artificial intelligence, it's common to refer to a set of propositions as a knowledge base, even when some of the propositions are uncertain. Some epistemologists attempt to distinguish belief from knowledge. After all, they claim, beliefs might not represent reality faithfully, whereas knowledge must. Because I don't think it's possible to decide whether or not a sentence, or a set of them, represents reality faithfully, whatever that might mean, I don't think it's possible to distinguish knowledge from belief in a qualitatively meaningful way. Nevertheless, many people speak as if there were a difference between believing something and knowing something. For example, I've occasionally had arguments with one of my colleagues, I'll call him Charlie, about something or other. These often ended by my saying, "I understand that you believe that, Charlie." Charlie would respond, poking me in the sternum, by saying, "I don't believe it, I know it." Whereas Charlie thought there was a real difference between believing and knowing, to me, the sternum poke simply indicated the strength of his belief. When someone says he knows some proposition, I interpret that to mean that he believes it very, very strongly, even when I might not believe it at all. Such a person may equivalently say that a strongly held proposition is true. The same applies for me. I will tend to say that I know things that I believe quite strongly, and I will label them true. Because people use the word know for their strong beliefs, they may think, like Charlie, that the difference between knowing something and believing something involves more than just the strength of a belief. I don't think there is a way to describe what that more might be. Chapter 6 of this audiobook will explore knowing and truth more thoroughly. Many of our beliefs fall in between strong belief and disbelief. Because our beliefs influence our actions, and because some of our actions might have profound consequences, I think it is important to evaluate beliefs carefully. Chapter 4 is devoted to methods for evaluating beliefs. I think the set of practices that has come to be called the scientific method, explored in Chapter 7, offers the most helpful way to evaluate beliefs of all kinds. Like scientific theories, all of our beliefs are, or should be, subject to change. This audiobook describes my beliefs about beliefs. It's written for those who, like myself, are interested in forming their own beliefs about beliefs. Many of my beliefs are quite controversial, and you may disagree with them, but after all, you can take them simply as my beliefs. 1. Beliefs, knowledge, and models. Our beliefs constitute a large part of our knowledge of the world. For example, I believe I exist on a planet that we call Earth and that I share it with billions of other people. I have beliefs about objects, such as automobiles, airplanes, computers, and various tools, and, to various degrees of detail, how they all operate. I have beliefs about the 21st century culture in which I live, about democracy and the rule of law, about the internet, and about science and the humanities, among other things. I have beliefs about many other people, including family, friends, associates, and even others yet unmet. And I believe they have beliefs also. To make an explicit list of all my beliefs would be impossible, yet all of these beliefs are there, somewhere and somehow represented in my brain, changing, growing, shrinking, and mostly ready for use when I need them. If I were to try to list my beliefs, I would do so using sentences in English, such as, "The universe is around 14 billion years old. Salem is the capital of Oregon. John Jones usually does what he says he is going to do," and so on. I can also state what I do not believe. For example, I do not believe in extrasensory perception. And I can state that I don't know something. For example, I don't know the population of Sri Lanka. We often refer to our beliefs, or to sets of them, as theories. We construct theories about everyday experience, both social and personal. Why are crime rates falling in New York City? Why did Booth assassinate Lincoln? Why is my child falling behind in school? Why is unemployment so high or so low? Scientific theories are proposed and argued over by scientists. There are theories to account for fossils found in rocks, for the sun's almost limitless energy, for earthquakes and volcanoes, for the diversity of life forms, for mental behavior, for the birth and death of stars, and for essentially everything else we can perceive about the universe. Usually, scientific theories are described by many sentences, replete with mathematics. They are written down in articles and books to supplement what's stored in the brains of scientists. When scientists say that they believe in quantum mechanics, for example, they are assenting to theories contained in certain articles and books about quantum mechanics. Scientific theories usually have to pass more stringent tests than do personal theories we all have about many things. Besides the literature of science, nonfiction books such as histories, political analyses, biographies, and narratives purport to set forth their author's beliefs about something. You and I might adopt some of these beliefs as our own. For example, you might say that you believe Stephen Ambrose's story about the Lewis and Clark expedition is told in his book, Undaunted Courage. Even books of fiction contain descriptions of the world that we might incorporate into our beliefs. One of the most important things to say about beliefs is that they are, or at least should be, tentative and changeable. For example, my belief that the weather will be sunny tomorrow, based on a weather forecast I consulted, may change as new weather data arrives. I may change some of my more fundamental beliefs also, such as my beliefs about early childhood education. Science and medicine advance by new experiments and new theoretical explanations, and these entail new or changed beliefs. Cognitive scientists distinguish various kinds of knowledge. Knowledge represented by beliefs is called declarative, because beliefs are stated as declarative sentences. No one really knows how beliefs are represented in our brains. The philosopher and cognitive scientist Jerry Fodor proposes that they are represented as sentence-like forms in a language of thought he calls mentalese. Neuroscientists, psychologists, and philosophers continue to argue about whether there are any such sentence-like representations in our brains at all. For our purposes, we won't worry about how beliefs are actually represented in the brain. Because we state them using sentences, it seems reasonable to think of them as sentences, constrained by the languages we use to construct sentences. Cognitive scientists also talk about other kinds of knowledge also. One of these is called procedural. Procedural knowledge is built into our practiced actions, such as swinging a golf club or riding a bicycle. For tasks that require real-time coordination between sensing and acting, procedural knowledge is more effective than declarative knowledge would be. After memorizing some sentences about how to do a cartwheel, could you do one? Analogously, the knowledge that a computer system uses when it parks a car or lands a plane automatically is of this procedural sort. Most likely, much of the knowledge that animals have about their world, such as how to construct spider webs, how to migrate, how to chase prey, and so on, is procedural. Procedural knowledge is important, but it is limited to those specific actions that it enables. The main reason that we humans are so much more versatile than other animals is that a good deal of our knowledge about the world is declarative, and thus can be used to guide many different actions. To use a rather mundane example, our belief that exercise promotes good health can encourage us to swim, to cycle, or to jog. Of equal importance to its utility in many different situations, declarative knowledge can be discussed and debated. Before we trust a belief sufficiently to act on it, we can analyze it and perhaps modify it, taking into account our own experiences, reasoning, and the opinions and criticisms of others. As the philosopher Karl Popper put it, by criticizing our theories, we can let our theories die in our stead. Beliefs constitute one of the ways we describe the world we live in. We also use mathematical equations, such as E equals mc squared, computer simulations of various phenomena, such as the weather, maps, and stories. The sum total of all these constitutes a model of reality, an accessible substitute for reality itself. We must make do with this substitute because we can't apprehend reality directly. It's on the other side of a sensory curtain. Even though it's easy to imagine that the objects, properties, and relations mentioned in our beliefs actually exist as part of reality, they are only components of the declarative part of our model of reality, a kind of virtual reality. As the physicist David Deutsch wrote, "Reality is out there, objective, physical, and independent of what we believe about it, but we never experience that reality directly. Every last scrap of our external experience is a virtual reality. And every last scrap of our knowledge, including our knowledge of the non-physical worlds of logic, mathematics, and philosophy, and of imagination, fiction, art, and fantasy, is encoded in the form of programs for the rendering of those worlds on our brain's own virtual reality generator. So it is not just science, reasoning about the physical world, that involves virtual reality. All reasoning, all thinking, and all external experience are forms of virtual reality. Even though virtual reality is not reality itself, it can feel very real. As the biologist and writer Richard Dawkins says, "Of course we feel as if we are firmly placed in the real world, which is exactly as it should be if our constrained virtual reality software is any good. It is very good, and the only time we notice it at all is on the rare occasions when it gets something wrong." Here's one way to think about the virtual reality that we inhabit. Imagine a pilot flying a giant jetliner through clouds. He can see nothing outside the plane with his own eyes, but must rely on the instrument panel displays, which inform him about the plane's position, speed, and relationship to the surrounding terrain. The plane is actually in the real world, of course, but all the pilot knows about it is represented in the virtual reality of the plane's meters, displays, and force feedback mechanisms. This virtual reality is not reality itself, but only a model of it. If the model is not a good one, the plane might be in danger of stalling, running out of fuel, or even colliding with a mountaintop. We are all in a situation similar to that of this airplane pilot. Our models are analogous to his instrument panel's meters and displays. Our beliefs are an important component of these models. Just as the airplane pilot wouldn't trust meters and displays that have not been thoroughly tested, we would do well not to trust beliefs that have not been rigorously evaluated. 2. What do beliefs do for us? Our beliefs serve us in several ways. Some help us make predictions and select actions. Some help us understand a subject in more detail. Some inspire creativity. Some generate emotional responses. And some can even be self-fulfilling. First, let's look at some of the ways people use beliefs to make predictions and select actions. In medicine, for example, physicians use their beliefs, learned in medical school and from journals, clinical studies, and on-the-job practice, to diagnose and predict the course of a disease and to prescribe a therapy predicted to cure or mitigate it. Corporate CEOs use their beliefs about business practices to predict the likely results of new strategies, capital allocations, reorganizations, and other actions that might be taken. Attorneys use their beliefs about torts, about the client, about precedents, and about the surrounding circumstances to devise a strategy for trying an injury case. In everyday life, we all make belief-based predictions. For example, if we believe that John Jones keeps his appointments, we can confidently predict that he will be there to meet us at the time and place he specified, which time and place, incidentally, are also represented as beliefs. Or if we believe a radio traffic report that our usual route to work is congested, we can predict that we will be delayed unless we choose a different route. More significantly, our beliefs help us make decisions about education, career choice, mate selection, child rearing, health practices, family finances, friendships, ethics, voting, and many other aspects of our personal lives. Actions evoked by these beliefs can have profound consequences, both beneficial and harmful. Consider, for example, the different consequences resulting from a physician's belief that certain antibiotics can cure bacterial pneumonia, contrasted with those resulting from a shaman's belief that pneumonia can be cured by magical incantations. We have the opportunity, and I think the duty, to scrutinize our beliefs carefully. How do our beliefs affect our actions? Sometimes they don't, at least not consciously. We seem to have many pre-stored, habitual routines, procedural knowledge for dealing with daily life. We drive our automobiles, run errands, and even engage in conversations largely on autopilot. Someone says something to us, and we frequently react without thinking. In these situations, we are doing what the psychologist Daniel Kahneman calls fast thinking. Kahneman, who won a Nobel Prize for his work on behavioral economics, suggests that our brains have two very different ways of thinking. One, which he calls System 1, does fast thinking. It uses built-in pattern recognition abilities, habits, and stored experiences to make rapid decisions. System 1 controls many of our routine daily activities. System 2, on the other hand, thinks more slowly. Its conclusions are arrived at by the deliberate use of whatever analytical and reasoning tools we happen to possess. Kahneman gives the following example to show the difference between the two systems. A bat and ball costs $1.10. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Many people come up with a fast answer, 10 cents, using System 1. But that's wrong. To do the math and find the correct answer, which is 5 cents, one needs to use System 2. Kahneman's book gives several other examples. For many situations, especially those in which a fast decision is required, fast thinking provides usable advice. It's a good thing, too, because trying to use slow-thinking methods all the time would paralyze us into inaction. But in less time-critical, high-stakes situations, fast thinking can lead us dangerously astray, and we should be thinking much more slowly and carefully. Here's how slow and careful thinking might work to choose an action based on beliefs. First, the current situation is perceived. Next, the most appropriate goal-achieving actions that can be taken in that situation are identified, and their likely effects are predicted. Finally, the action that leads to the most desirable effects is selected. Our beliefs play important roles in perceiving a current situation, in identifying appropriate actions, and in predicting the effects of these actions. As I will note in Chapter 3, what we perceive is highly dependent on our belief-dependent expectations, and what we expect to be the results of an action depends on our beliefs about how...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.